Hello everyone, welcome to our webinar, What If That Pretty Chart Is Just Plain Wrong? Before we start the webinar, I have a few housekeeping items to share. We will have a Q&A at the end of this webinar. You'll see a small window that says Q&A on your right upper corner of your window. At any time you have a question, you can put the questions in, and then we'll try and get to them during the webinar. If not, we'll definitely get to them at the end of the webinar. We are recording this webinar, and we will send you the recording and the slides. Our presenters today are Daniel Mintz from Looker. He's our Chief Data Evangelist, and Matt Cracknell. He's a Customer Success Manager. And I will hand it off to Daniel.
Thanks. So to get us started on today's webinar, I thought it would be good to do a couple of definitions just to sort of level set and make sure everyone's on the same page. So the first important definition is what we mean by workbook analytics. And this really goes to that question of, well, what if that pretty chart you're looking at is just plain wrong, right? And so what we mean by a workbook analytics is, first of all, it's a locally installed application. That means it's an application that you download and install on your laptop or your desktop. And these applications, these workbooks, include both the data and the analysis of the data that sort of makes sense of it. And so the data, because it's included in the workbook, is actually a snapshot. It was an extract of the data that was taken a while ago. And, you know, these workbook analytic tools, they tend to work best with extracts. And the reason for this is because that's sort of how they're architected. They're architected to take advantage of the speed and power of your machine to make it really fast to be able to sort of slice and dice the data. Now, the problem or one problem that comes up with this is that workbook analytics, because they're workbooks that live on your local machine, often make sharing and collaboration hard. And you can think about how this works as a sort of non-data example. If you think about the way that Microsoft Word versus Google Docs work, right? If you're working on a Word document, it lives on your computer. All of your changes and your track changes live on your computer until you send them in an email to one of your colleagues, and then they continue working on it on their computer. And now there are sort of two versions of this document floating out there. And if you guys get out of sync or someone else is working on the document while you're working on the document, it can be very difficult to sort of merge those changes. Whereas if you're working with Google Docs, there's only a single version of the document that ever exists. It lives on a website in the cloud, and everyone accesses the same one. They're always seeing the most up-to-date version of that because they're accessing the single version in the cloud. So that's what we mean by workbook analytics. And just to give a really quick history lesson in terms of sort of where did workbook analytics come from, you know, if we go all the way back to the 1980s, you know, we think of that as sort of the first wave of BI. It's when we saw the first real BI tools entering the market. And those tools tended to be very developer-centric. Though back then it was sort of called IT. That's what we called everybody who worked with technology back then. And the reason that it was owned by IT, that it was very IT-centric, was just because they were the only ones who understood how technology worked. And when you had one of those first wave BI tools, whether it be Cognos or Business Objects or MicroStrategy, it was sitting on top of a data appliance, a really powerful, for the time at least, server that could process tons of data. And, you know, the only way that you got access to that data was through this tool that was owned by IT. And so if you wanted a new dashboard or a new report, you had to go and request those from IT, and you often had to wait a really long time. These tools were not terribly flexible. The data appliances that were, you know, the warehouses back then were quite slow by today's standards for sure. And so, you know, grooming the data and getting a new dashboard built and ready could take months or even years. And what happened was, over time, users got tired of waiting for IT. And, you know, at the same time, computers, desktop computers, even laptop computers, were getting faster. People had machines, you know, that were their PCs that couldn't handle all of the data that lived in the data warehouse, but could handle enough of it to be useful. And so you start to see these self-service tools that come onto the market, things like Click in 1993 and then Tableau in 2003, and we're talking here about that sort of late 90s, early 2000s period. And these tools, they don't fully displace the first wave of tools, but they do gain sort of more widespread acceptance because people were so tired of waiting on IT, and now all of a sudden they can extract some of the data from the warehouse, put it into one of these self-service visualization tools, and do the analysis themselves without waiting. So, you know, this, I guess, leads to the question of, well, why would you use workbooks? And, you know, as I said, a big reason is you're not dependent on the warehouse, right? You get your extract from the warehouse, you get your data, you put it into your workbook, and now you can self-serve because you can slice and dice that data however you want. You don't need to go back to IT until you need a new extract. And these tools are great for a single analyst. If you're a single analyst who, you know, is just trying to slice and dice some data to make sense of it, you know, this workbook tool is going to be loads better than one of those dashboarding tools that existed in the first wave, because you can actually, you know, you can do an analysis with the data. You don't have to wait. And, you know, those warehouses in the old days, often you'd start a job in the afternoon and come back the next morning and it'd still be running. And, you know, these tools are meant to be worked with in sort of real time. You know, they're very quick, they're very responsive, always getting quicker and more responsive as your computer, your PC gets faster. And because the way that the sort of output of these tools was presented to other users was often through visualization, these tools become, you know, known for really great visualizations. You know, I think Tableau is the exemplar here, where, you know, they have just an amazing visualization suite that's grown up over the last, you know, almost or 15 years. So that's why workbooks are used, and that, you know, was where things stood until 5 or 10 years ago. And then things started changing. And the biggest change that came really from the big data revolution was that databases went from being these very slow, very expensive things that had to be protected by IT because they couldn't handle ad hoc queries. They certainly couldn't handle lots of users asking questions of them at the same time. They went from being that to being these incredibly fast, incredibly cheap databases that are available now and are often available in the cloud with very little DevOps maintenance required, right? So, you know, this starts with the emergence of the Hadoop ecosystem in the early to mid-2000s, and now has expanded with cloud MPP databases like Redshift and Google BigQuery and Snowflake and Vertica. And so, you know, you now all of a sudden, instead of having this database that needs protecting, you have a database that actually could handle everybody who wants to ask the questions. And you also have more data than ever before, right? We've got IoT, Internet of Things, and we've got, you know, every SaaS tool under the sun, all of them producing data. And all of that data is getting piped into storage and into data warehouses. And you also have more people in the enterprise than ever before who rely on data to do their jobs, whether it's marketing professionals who need to build, you know, attribution models, or sales people who need to track the funnel, or logistics folks who need to track where packages and are and how warehouses are performing. Finance, obviously, you know, every department is becoming more and more data-driven every day. So because of that, you know, that changing world, we started to run into some challenges that workbook BI and workbook analytics pose. And so I'm going to hand it off to my colleague, Matt, who's got great experience, you know, working with some of these workbook tools to talk about some of the challenges that people run into with them.
Thanks, Daniel. The first challenge we'll talk about is trust. And trust's an important factor when it comes to data, right? Interestingly, the biggest challenge in BI isn't the tech stack or the tool itself. It's actually the cultural shift, right? The how do we get people to embrace data and use it in their day-to-day decision-making process? And that's hard enough as it is, but if the tool that you're using means the answers you get aren't correct, then your initiative to democratize data is going to be an absolute non-starter. And the issue with some of these workbook tools is that the way they operate lends itself to the possibility of erroneous data. For example, let's take a common KPI for e-commerce or retail, average lifetime value of customer. Now, there should really only be one single way of calculating that across the entire business. But the problem with workbook tools is that each of my users can individually connect to multiple disparate data sources and work within the confines of their own workbook. So in that case, how do we ensure consistency when each user is writing their own calculations or collecting data at different levels of freshness, right? No one is going to get the same answer, despite the fact they're all asking the same question. And what actually happens is these users get into a meeting, and that allocated time is spent discussing who is right, or even trying to unpick or audit the calculations, which is crazily complex, time-consuming, and eventually no one trusts the data. Now, some of these tools have implemented sharing of workbooks in a separate piece of software, for example, a server, to try and resolve some of these issues. But ultimately, there's no enforcement, right? If I have source access, I can circumvent that connection or workbook and connect whatever I want. So I still misdefine or miscalculate these KPIs. Ultimately, governance and control is lacking in this approach, and the end result is a complete lack of trust in the data. I'll hand back to Daniel to talk us through how we make data more trustworthy.
Thanks, Matt. So yeah, the question here is, you know, how do we make data more trustworthy? How do we ensure that that pretty chart we're looking at is not wrong, but is in fact right and trustworthy? And, you know, the answer here is really dependent on that revolution that I talked about, the way that the underlying data stack has changed. Because with that faster, cheaper cloud-based tools, or on-premise tools for that matter, because they're all getting faster and cheaper every day, but with those tools that no longer need to be protected, you can actually take a very different approach than the workbook approach. And that approach, we refer to it as a data platform. And what a data platform does is, rather than pulling data out and, you know, putting that data onto somebody's laptop, it leaves the data in the warehouse and it puts the model right on top. It lets everyone access the data through that same model. And when we talk about a model here, we're talking fundamentally just about a way to define the things that are important to your business in terms of the data, right? So if lifetime customer value is defined as A plus B divided by C, you know, that's something that can go right into the data platform. And when you need to say, well, now it's A plus B plus D divided by C, you can make that change in the data platform, and the data stays, you know, in the database, and everybody sees that new definition. And what's really happening here is that analysts, who have been the keepers of the knowledge about what the data means, they're getting the knowledge out of their head and into software. And that's really great, because it's really easy to scale software up, and it's really hard to scale people up, or at least it's very expensive. And when the logic all lives in one place, rather than in a, you know, hundreds or thousands of workbooks all across the enterprise, what that allows you to do, first of all, is it allows you to impose version control, which is, you know, a thing that software developers have been using for decades, where, you know, they keep track of every version of the code that has existed over time. And so you can see, when was a change made, why was it made, what was the change? You can always see all of those things, all of that history. And that's possible because, you know, the logic is separate from the data. If you were trying to keep every version of the data that had ever existed, that would get very large very quickly. But when all you're doing is keeping track of the logic, that's actually a very small amount of information to keep track of. It also, because it's a small amount of information and very concise, it also makes it really easy to audit the logic, right? It makes it easy for someone else to come in and say, how are we defining lifetime customer value? I want to take a look at that and make sure that it's up to date. And they don't have to go track down a ton of workbooks to figure out how, you know, everyone across the organization are doing it. They track down the one spot in the platform where it's defined, and they take a look and make sure it's right. And, you know, what this does across the board is it keeps everyone on the same page. You know, as Matt said, it can be really frustrating to get into a meeting where people are arguing about whose data is right. It would be a lot better if everyone came in with the same understanding of the data, so that rather than having that argument, you can actually use the meeting productively and plot strategy. So rather than, you know, talking only in the sort of abstract, we're gonna pull out some examples of specific customers who have faced these challenges throughout the webinar. And so first, Matt is gonna talk about DigitalOcean, one of our great customers in New York, to talk about the problems that they faced.
Thanks, Daniel. So these guys are a cloud platform for developers. It's where you can host projects, websites, or even applications. A client base of more than 800,000 developers worldwide. There are a number of challenges when we engage them. The first was they felt unable to tap into their data to better serve their client base of those developers. And they weren't able to understand how to address the demands of those customers using the data. And the key one, I think, was you know, they weren't able to get visibility into other teams' data to help them make better decisions. The tech stack at the time was Excel and Tableau. The situation was multiple definitions of the truth, right? No agreement on whose answer was correct, so back to that meeting scenario. The inability to get visibility into other teams' data analysis, which really hindered collaboration and sharing with regards to data. And the infrastructure they had didn't scale, and this was as requirements, use cases, and user volumes were increasing. In terms of the solution, Looker was able to provide a single source of truth across the company. It allowed individuals to answer their data questions, but also allowed teams to collaborate and leverage others' work. Ultimately, the combined result of this was to massive growth in data confidence across the business and allowing the goal achievement of improving service to the client base with increased speed and efficiency. So the second challenge we'll talk about here is reusability, right? And if you think about it, there's only really two outcomes when you ask a question in your BI tool. Either it's a throwaway question and you just move on, or it's a repeatable one, one that gets asked over and over, where the answer changes over time and it needs to be monitored. And in this case, the latter case, you know, that data should be 100% centralized into the warehouse with governance applied. The KPIs being measured, I think, should be defined, agreed, and version controlled within a data platform. Because what's the alternative, right? It's back to those multiple users creating multiple connections to various data sources and creating their own workbooks. And this very, you know, connection experience usually requires some kind of data manipulation or cleanup, either in the tool itself or using a separate cleanup tool, which just means repetitive, you know, unnecessary work. And this process not only creates inaccuracies, as we mentioned previously, but also a large amount of duplicated content. Additionally, if I'm always starting from scratch, I lose the ability to improve on what's gone before, right? To take someone else's work, tweak it, elaborate it, and ultimately evolve it to help drive the business forwards. I also risk losing others' knowledge of the data, right, and what exactly it means. You know, marketing understand attribution data. The IT team understand web traffic data. If I'm doing this all on my own from scratch every time, it's much easier to make mistakes and completely misinterpret the data. So I'll pass back to Daniel to talk through reusability in the data platform.
So yeah, you know, this reusability question is a really critical one. No one likes doing unnecessary work. No one likes doing the same thing over and over. And so, you know, the way that a data platform approaches this question, again, is by centralizing this logic in one place, you know, it makes it really easy to find that work that others have done. You know, I, whether you're working with workbook analytics and you have a whole slew of workbooks saved on your desktop, or you're working with SQL files if you're a more technical person, and you have, you know, a whole slew of SQL files saved on your desktop and don't remember which one does what, you know, often there's just not a lot of organization to the way that we organize analytics files, and a data platform gives you a structure in which to organize it. And that avoids doing that repeated work because, you know, you can, if someone has already done the cleanup work on a particular table, you can, you know, just use that that cleanup work and leverage it rather than having to do it again yourself. Also, because metrics are defined once and then referenced, it avoids doing that extra work, and it also avoids confusion because there aren't multiple places where a metric is defined, right? And this, again, is a sort of concept from software development where they have an expression, don't repeat yourself. You define something once, and then every other time that you want to use it, you reference that single definition. And what that means is that when you make a change, you make that change in one place to the one definition, and then that flows outward automatically to all the other references. If, on the other hand, you're defining the same thing, we'll keep using that example, lifetime customer value, in 10 different places, when that changes, you have to go track down all 10. And if you miss one, now you have you have reports that are out of sync or dashboards that are out of sync and giving the wrong data. We also, constantly are facing this question of joining data, right? A lot of the most powerful, most insightful analysis comes from joining different sources of data. And, when we do that at the sort of data level, we do it with an operation called the join. But, when two tables join, they usually do it in the same way over and over, right? If I've got an orders table that tracks orders and I've got a users table that tracks users, if I need to join those two tables, chances are I'm going to do it by joining them using the user ID, because that's an ID field that exists in both tables, and that's always going to be the join pattern. Now, I actually shouldn't really have to keep track of that. As a person, there's no reason for me to have to keep track of that. I should be able to write that down once and then let software worry about writing the actual join anytime that I need it. Obviously the user's orders join is a pretty simple one, but when you're trying to keep track of dozens or hundreds of different tables and how they relate to each other, it would be much better to be able to define that once and then let the software use the appropriate join logic as it's needed. And that's what a data platform lets you do. And also, as Matt said, there's this real issue with data familiarity, where when I'm trying to work with data that I'm not familiar with, that can be a real problem because I don't know what the key fields are. I don't know, I need to, make sure that I take account of this extra field, because if I don't, all my analyses will be wrong. And so I have to go track down the analyst who works with that data regularly. But when that analyst can take their knowledge and get it out of their head and into the platform, when I am working in the platform, I benefit from that knowledge immediately. I don't have to go track that analyst down because they've written down what they know about the data so that I'm doing the right thing automatically. So let me hand it back to Matt to talk about another customer who faced this question of, how do we reuse things rather than redoing Simply Business?
So Simply Business are the UK's largest online business insurance broker, over 300,000 policyholders. And their goal as a company is to simplify the experience of selecting and purchasing small business insurance. Number of challenges for these guys. One was keeping up with the increasing frequency and speed at which customers and employees requested both initial information, but also follow-up questions, change requests, what-if questions, for example. Getting user, product, and website data into the hands of those who needed it in a timely fashion. And essentially agile access to data for day-to-day analysis. Tech stack was MongoDB and Redshift, and the front end was Excel and Tableau. So the situation for Simply Business was, the pace at which data was available couldn't meet the business needs. There were multiple copies of data, which proved confusing, and long turnaround times waiting for reports meant that the model was not scalable. So the Looker solution, the platform meant that there was no more waiting for new workbooks, as anyone could self-serve on the data. Ultimately, the business decision makers weren't reliant on analysts, as the data was available for everyone on demand. They were also able to connect to Redshift directly, leverage power and functionality, and create this kind of data model that maintained a single source of truth, removing the issue of multiple copies of data and workbooks. So the last problem we'll touch on is scalability. And the issue here, and I think Daniel touched on that earlier, is that workbook-based tools are predominantly extract-based, right? That's what they're designed to do. As soon as you remove data out of the warehouse or the database, it's no longer fresh, right? It's stale. Not to mention the additional challenges around copies, all over the business, copies of data. There's also the architecture standpoint to consider. A lot of these workbook tools, aren't built to leverage the power and functionality of the new breed of MPP databases, right? Most of these tools are 15 plus years old, and things like Redshift and BigQuery and Snowflake, it just weren't around 15 years ago, right? And then finally, there's the challenge around collaboration and standardization of business logic, right, and scalability to internal users. If I need to update a KPI or a metric that is used across multiple workbooks or connections, I physically literally have to go to every single place it appears, right? And that's fine when I'm a small team of, you know, two or three analysts and maybe, you know, three or four consumers, that's fine. But you buy your BI tool to scale it, right? To democratize data, to make sure that everyone in the business can use data to answer questions. And when you get to, you know, tens or hundreds of users, having to manually update just becomes, you know, a logistical nightmare and almost impossible. Back to you, Daniel.
Great, thanks, Matt. So yeah, you know, the piece here that I want to touch on is just that, you know, the data platform, because it's actually sort of a lightweight way of accessing the data rather than the sort of heavyweight way of accessing the data that is workbooks, it really scales quite seamlessly, right? It lets the databases that are so powerful do their job and use all their horsepower to process the data, and lets the platform do its sort of lighter weight job of keeping track of what the data means. You know, by leaving the data in your database, you're keeping the logic lightweight and agile, whereas once it gets tied together with that data in a workbook, it loses that agility, loses that ability to scale. You know, another thing that we see a lot is the thing about a platform is it's database agnostic. You know, I think Looker now supports 34 different SQL dialects natively. And what we see a lot is we see customers who start using Looker as their data platform on top of a single, you know, one database, maybe a Postgres or MySQL database that they've been using for transactions. And then they say, you know what, this just isn't powerful enough for us. We need to upgrade to a Redshift or a BigQuery or a Snowflake. And normally what that would mean is an enormous amount of work to translate all of the queries that do your ETLs and that power your dashboards and that power your extracts from one dialect to another. But when you're using a data platform and the data platform doesn't care what database is underneath it, the data platform can take care of taking the way that you've written the logic and writing it in the appropriate SQL for the dialect that you're using. And so we've seen lots of customers actually make the switch from one database to another seamlessly in a matter of hours rather than weeks. And another thing that happens with a data platform, because you're still connected to your data warehouse rather than working with an extract, is that you always have the lowest level, the row level detail available to you, and not just in, you know, the one area that you're examining, but really across the board. You know, if you're in finance and the extract that you're working on is financial data, but then you realize, well, oh, shoot, I need some sales data to join in, you don't have access to that. You have to go back and get a new extract because that wasn't part of your extract. If, on the other hand, you're still connected to your database, you know, accessing that sales data, as long as it's in the same database and you have permission to see it, is really easy because it's all there, right? And, you know, just to go back to the sort of historical piece that I talked about at the beginning, you know, I think the thing that's kind of interesting is that first wave of BI, those very locked down IT-centric dashboard tools that were totally unagile, they actually scaled pretty well. You know, that was part of what made them work. Now, people weren't getting a ton of value from them because all they were getting was, you know, one or two dashboards or reports. But they were built to serve a lot of users, for a lot of users to see those very few things, those dashboards, right? And when we moved to the second wave, to these self-service, you know, workbook tools, we saw that the ability to scale and serve a lot of users simultaneously really went away, right? That it was part of the trade-off. It said, well, we want more agility. We want more ability to answer our own questions, to self-serve. And so we're willing to give up the ability to keep lots of people using the same tool and on the same page. Because fundamentally, if, you know, 100 or 1,000 people are all using their own workbooks, even if it's the same tool, the same brand name tool that they're using to access those workbooks, they're not really all using the same tool. If 1,000 people are all using, you know, workbooks in Excel, they're not actually all on the same page. They're not all using the same tool. They're each using their own version of the same tool. And that's where you really get into these scaling issues. A data platform, this third wave, gives you the scalability that you had with the first wave and the agility that you had with the second wave. And it does that simply by leveraging the incredible sort of technology revolution that's happened. And it's not, you know, we're certainly not saying that the people who built Tableau or Click or MicroStrategy or Business Objects made bad decisions or were dumb in any way. They weren't. They were building incredible tools at the time. The problem is the times have changed, and the constraints that decided how they were going to architect their tools have gone away. And so, you know, when those constraints go away, it opens up all these new possibilities for you. So our last customer example here, I'm going to talk about Square. You're probably familiar with Square. They're a huge mobile financial processing firm. You know, they're the ones who make those little readers that plug into your phone so that people can swipe your credit card right on the go. As you would expect from sort of a venture-backed, you know, financial technology firm, they were very data-driven from the start. And they also were scaling really, really fast. And, you know, as a lot of places do, they sort of started with Excel and then layered on Tableau as a workbook tool on top of that, you know, because Tableau is, in a lot of ways, it's kind of like Excel on steroids, right? But what they found was that combination of growing fast and trying to stay data-driven, those two things didn't go together with these workbook tools. Because what they ended up with was 2,500 workbooks, which is just an astonishing number. And there's simply no way to keep 2,500 workbooks, you know, up to date, in sync. It's just impossible. And, you know, what happened was the analysts and the finance folks were trying to build reports for their customers to give them updates, you know, on a really critical piece of information. How much money did they have coming to them? But building those reports often took, you know, a couple of weeks, and they had to be manually maintained. And, you know, when it was time to rebuild those reports, it was, you know, they were starting from scratch each time. And what happened was the data team really was becoming a bottleneck and preventing them from continuing to be data-driven while they scaled. So Square is actually relatively early in their implementation of Looker, switching over to a data platform, but already they're seeing huge benefits. You know, they're connecting directly to Vertica, which is the data warehouse that they're using, rather than relying on extracts. They're aiming to get up above 500 data-driven users, 500 people in the tool every day. And that simply wasn't even on their radar when they were using workbook tools. And now, they're well on their way to achieving it. They now have, you know, the finance team and the analysts have a centralized reporting platform that can change with the business, where they make the change once and it takes effect across the business. So they're not having to rely on, rebuilding from scratch. And they know that the metrics are right. And particularly for a firm dealing with finance, that's more critical than anything you can imagine, right? And so they know that, you know, nobody's freelancing and making up their own definition of metrics and delivering bad data to customers. That's a little bit about sort of the differences between using workbook analytics and using a data platform. And I'm going to let Matt wrap up before we get to your questions.
Thanks very much. So in summary, kind of three main themes. The first, you know, one central data platform. So this platform lets everyone access the same model data source, right? So no more multiple connections, multiple cleanup required. In essence, no more repeated and unnecessary work. Seamless version control and audit capabilities through things like Git integration, which is one of our most popular features with customers. One version of your business logic. So the model means that it's defined in a single place, right? So your single source of truth or your users. It means collaboration between teams and sharing of data knowledge. And then one tool that scales. So leverage your investment in your data warehouse, right? But as Daniel said, don't stay locked into it. If you want to change, you'll be free to change. Give your end users true row level detail, because you're live against this warehouse, right? Quite important. And then, you know, make updating logic and data fast and easy. So when I want to make changes to the data or model, I just change once in one place, but I affect changes, you know, everywhere seamlessly, wherever that data resides. So thanks for your time, everyone. We'll open up the floor to questions.
Great. Thanks, Matt. Our first question is, you mentioned the data model. Who creates that? Is that like a data cube?
Yeah, sure. I'll take that one. That's a great question. So, yeah, I mean, this idea of a data model is actually something that goes way back to the very beginning of BI. And, you know, what we mean by a data model is simply, you know, your data is probably raw. It's probably reasonably dirty. If it's like everybody else's data, that's not a knock against your data in particular, but, you know, just data comes in dirty. It needs to be cleaned up. It needs to be transformed. It needs to be reshaped into something that the business understands and cares about, right? And, you know, whether that's taking taking multiple page views and saying, okay, these together constitute a session, or taking, you know, multiple orders and describing a user's lifetime value or a user's lifetime behavior. You know, there are business questions that are just different than the questions that you see in the raw data. And so what a data model is it's that logic that makes the sort of data make sense, right? It's the business's way of imposing order on the data and taking that raw data and converting it into something useful for the business. And, you know, the second part of the question is that like a data cube? So this idea of cubing data is something, again, that goes back to sort of the beginning of BI. Folks have probably encountered it if they've been working in the BI space for a while. And a data cube is a way of sort of dimensionalizing data, you know, slicing data so that you could say, all right, I want to see sales by store, by, you know, year, by month, by week, by date. And it's a way of organizing the data to allow that. But, you know, cubes largely came about because of the constraints of the underlying database. You know, cubes were a way of sort of reducing the size of the data that you were dealing with, so that the databases could return answers pretty quickly. And, you know, with today's data, I think this idea of modeling sometimes involves cubing, but more often involves sort of more advanced, newer techniques that simply weren't doable in the old days, didn't make sense when you're working on a slower database. And, you know, I actually spoke about this idea of data modeling in the new world at Google's Next conference with one of the product managers from BigQuery there. Their data warehouse offering, and there's just a whole bunch more options. Sometimes you still use cubes, but you know, sometimes you use the third normal form for any database geeks on the phone. But sometimes you want to use different patterns that more closely resemble sort of what you're trying to do with the data and do with your business. It's a great question.
Great. Just a reminder: if anyone has questions, please put them in the little window on your right hand side. Next question is: are you able to demo your database and software?
Matt, do you want to take that one?
Yeah, I will. The answer is yes, definitely. Due to time constraints, we can't do a demo on the Looker platform right now, but we'll have someone reach out to you to set up a demo as soon as possible. The question is, what's it like for a non-technical person to use Looker, and can they make their own reports or dashboards? In terms of making their own content, definitely. That's really important, right? For an end user, they will normally arrive at a dashboard, but dashboards, we all know, tend to raise more questions than they actually answer. So the ability for them to dive in and ask their own questions is really, really important. And that functionality exists in Looker. We call that explores, and that can be done from within the web interface. In terms of the actual experience, it's really easy, right? So Looker is web-based. So in terms of interaction, it's just through a browser. And the whole UI is designed for people to easily ask questions of their data using the model that Daniel described earlier, right? So using the analyst knowledge that's been baked into that data model, using that to answer questions of their data makes it, you know, super easy to use. Anything you'd add to that, Daniel?
No, that was great.
Okay. So the next question is, how do these case study companies change staffing on their data teams after adopting Looker? Did data staff shift role? And did the companies find it easy to embed analytics with business teams?
Sure. Yeah, I'm happy to take that one. So, I mean, I think what we see, you know, without getting too far into the specifics of each company, but rather speaking a bit more generally about, you know, what we see companies doing, and frankly speaking from my own experience, because before I worked for Looker, I was actually a customer of Looker's for 3 years when I ran data and analytics at Upworthy, the media company. And, you know, I think when you talk to analysts about their implementation of Looker, the thing that they really love is that Looker makes it so that they can spend a lot less time on the boring, repetitive tasks of, you know, a business person comes to them and says, hey, I need sales data, you know, by country for the last 4 weeks. And then they pull that report and somebody comes back and says, oh, you know, actually we need we need the last 6 weeks and you only pulled the last 4 weeks. Sorry, I know we asked the wrong question. Can you fix it? That is not a data analyst's idea of a nice way to spend their day. But for too many analysts, that is really the way that they spend their day. And so Looker, by allowing people to self-serve to that data and not be reliant on the analyst team to build them dashboards or reliant on IT to get them extracts from the data warehouse, it really allows those analysts to work on higher value questions, more interesting questions that can really drive the business forward. And in general, that makes business users happier because they can self-serve, and it makes analysts happier because they're not stuck answering those same boring questions over and over. So, you know, I think that's a shift that we see over and over when companies adopt Looker. And, you know, in terms of how they embed analysts with business teams, you know, I think there are a bunch of different very successful ways to structure an analytics team. You know, I know lots of companies who have done it in several different ways and had success. But I think the key piece here is just having tooling that keeps everybody on the same page, no matter how you organize the data team, makes a huge difference. Because, you know, I know Carl Anderson, who is now at WeWork and used to run data science at Warby Parker, he wrote a great blog post about his time at Warby Parker, where he talked about how the implementation of Looker, it actually forced them to confront some tough questions about what their data meant. It forced him to go around department to department and ask them, you know, hey, let me see the ugly insides of your workbooks so I can understand how you're defining this key business metric. And when he did that, what he realized was that different teams were defining them differently. And so implementing Looker forced them to get everybody in a room together and say, all right, what is our definition of a returning customer? Let's all agree on that. Let's put it in the software, and then everyone will use that same definition. And so, you know, implementing Looker made a huge difference, not just on the technical side, but also on the sort of cultural side of getting to data-drivenness, where it forced them to get everybody onto the same page so that they could make better decisions with data.
Great. Thanks, Daniel. I want to thank everyone. That was the last of the questions. I want to thank everyone for attending our webinar. Again, if you have any questions, you can email us at discover@looker.com. We have resources in our research center. We have white papers, videos, archived webinars. You should go to looker.com/learn. And there was a request for a demo. If you go to looker.com/demo or even shoot us an email, we'll be happy to give you a demo of our product. So that wraps us up. Thank you again for coming. I will be sending you the recording and slides in the next day or two.
Thanks, everybody.
Thanks.